7 o'clock, we're going to call tonight's hearing to order. The August 4th meeting of the Zoning Board of Appeals. Before we go through with the reading of the legal notice, I've been asked to say that tonight's meeting of the Zoning Board of Appeals is being recorded on RCTV. It is viewable live on Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33, and tonight's meeting's videographer is Rob M. Thank you. Tonight we're here to call case number 1614, and that is a public hearing in the Selectman's Meeting Room on the petition of CJM Builders, Inc., who seeks a variance under Section 532 of the zoning bylaws in order to demolish an existing single-family and to construct a new two-family dwelling as per the plans on the property located at 183 Salem Street in Reading, Massachusetts. I'm not going to read, unless there's an objection, read the abutters list, except to say that all the abutters were notified, as were all the appropriate boards and boards, departments, and committees in town, as well as planning boards of Wakefield, North Reading, Woburn, Linfield, Stone, and Wilmington. Testimony tonight before this board is taken under oath, so if you think you may want to speak, please stand and raise your right hand, even if you think you may have something to say later. Doesn't hurt to be sworn now. Okay, I swear.
Doesn't hurt.
Yeah.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, is that include counsel?
No, counsel, your oath is well known. I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. The response is, I do. Oh, thank you. All right, so we're going to go ahead and hear from the petitioner, and the floor is yours, counsel.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. Good evening. My name is Michael Newhouse. I'm counsel for the applicant, CJM Builders. For the record, I have an office at 2026th Avenue in Wilmington, Mass. Appearing before you this evening on behalf of CJM Builders, Inc., who's under agreement to purchase the property at 183 Salem. Currently, that property is owned by Marjorie Cavanaugh, who's also known as Marjorie McMahon. The property that, as it currently exists, is located in S-15 zoning district. The lot is conforming with regard to area and frontage. In fact, it has 100 feet of frontage on Salem Street and 150 feet of frontage on the intersecting street of Johannes. There is one non-conformity respect to the property. That's a detached garage which encroaches on two different lot lines. It's as close as 0.2 feet to one of the lot lines, and it's approximately 8.3 feet from the other lot line. So it is non-conforming with respect to the detached garage. As the board is aware, we seek a variance this evening from Section 532 of the zoning bylaw, which generally prohibits the use of a structure in that district as a two-family with certain exceptions. One of the exceptions that would enable a two-family to be used as a matter of right would be a situation that this property actually qualifies for, and that is that it has at least 8 habitable finished rooms, and it was constructed prior to 1948. In fact, it was constructed in approximately 1960. The property could be converted to a two-family use as a matter of right, provided that the structure would continue to have the character and appearance of a single-family dwelling. Frankly, as was the case that this board has seen previously for an application on Washington Street a couple years ago, the property is fairly unique in that it is in a unique state of disrepair. It's in a unique state of distress. So the viability of actually converting it to a two-family using the existing dwelling, it's not viable economically and probably not structurally. As the board well knows, there are 4 criteria that we have to meet in order for the board to grant the relief that's requested here. I believe that we've summarized the arguments on each one of the criteria in the application, but if it please the board. I'd like to just quickly run through those four criteria, point out to the board and to anyone here that's interested why we believe that it meets all those four criteria, and that if it's the board's discretion to grant the relief, it's perfectly appropriate. First, with respect to a variance, as the board knows, we have to prove that the condition of the property is either the condition of the structure or the area is such that the failure to get the variance would affect the ability to redevelop the property. I'm sorry. In this particular case, this lot that the house currently is located on is actually larger than most of the lots in the immediate vicinity. As I indicated, the lot is conforming with regard to area. It's in excess of 15,000 square feet, and it's actually 58% larger than one of the directly abutting lots, and it's about 33% larger than the other directly abutting lot. So those two directly abutting lots, with regard to, as compared to our instant case, really demonstrate that it's appropriate to have a structure that is laid out on the plan that the board has, and that it's appropriate for the neighborhood. We also have to demonstrate that a literal enforcement would cause a financial hardship. It's my understanding that the current owner of the property has provided a letter to the board. I'm in receipt of a copy of it, which I believe was submitted to the board, which really kind of summarizes the history and the personal circumstances such that the property has come to be in such a state of disrepair. It's largely driven by economics and the ability to afford to be able to continue to maintain the property. I think the current owner can speak to the economic hardship far better than I, but I think that certainly her letter and any testimony in that regard would be compelling for the board. Obviously, at least obvious to the board, we have to also provide some evidence that the relief that we're granting wouldn't be substantially detrimental to the public good. In this particular case, not only would it not be detrimental to the public good, I really think anybody who has been in the neighborhood and who's seen the quality of the houses around it would acknowledge that a new two-family residence that is properly situated on the lot fronting on Johannes would be a big improvement to that neighborhood, and in fact a big improvement to the town. Also, in terms of the neighborhood and whether or not a two-family would be detrimental, within a stone's throw of this property, there are 16 different two-family houses that are already being used for that purpose. Just four doors down, you have the Maplewood Village development that's, I can't even remember how many units are there, but that, as the board will recall, is a 40B development. And the 16 other nearby properties that are used as two-family residences, only three of them have lots that are actually larger than this subject property. So for all of those reasons, we believe that not only wouldn't the granting of the relief be detrimental to the town and to the public good, to the contrary, this would be a big improvement to the neighborhood and to the town. I think it's worthy to note that if the plan before you is approved and the building moves forward and constructs what's on the table, it will comply with all of the dimensional requirements, including building coverage, including setbacks, and as I already mentioned, it's got frontage in excess of 100 feet on Johannes. So it'll be compliant in every respect, but for the relief that is requested. And again, as a two-family, it can be converted for that purpose, so it doesn't derogate from the bylaw to the extent that the bylaw actually provides, as a matter of right, the ability to use a two-family. It's really just this specific architectural style, which will really appear to be a two-family and won't be kind of disguised as a single family. So if the board has any questions, I'd be happy to answer them, as well as any butters or other interested parties have any questions, I'd be happy to give some feedback. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Before I invite the board to ask questions, members to ask questions, I'd like to read a couple of things into the record. The first is a note from Glenn Redmond, the building inspector, who writes that the property is writes to the board that this property is a single-family dwelling located in an S-15 district, which allows single-family dwellings. I have inspected the existing dwelling on December 16, 2015. The existing dwelling contains a minimum of 8 finished and habitable rooms and has existed prior to April 1942. Under section 532, note 1, it is of my opinion that this dwelling qualifies to be altered into a two-family dwelling. A building permit to convert this existing structure to a two-family dwelling can be issued as of right without ZBA approval. The proposal to demolish the single-family dwelling and to construct a new two-family dwelling requires a variance from section 532. Why we're here. I'd also like to note for the record, without necessarily reading into the record, and I understand the applicant is here, but we did get a handwritten note from the current owner, dated August 2016, that describes her circumstances and is a request to the board to consider those circumstances with the current application. With that, we do have a couple of notes from concerned citizens, and we'll wait for the public portion of the hearing to read those in or refer those into the record. But for now, I'll entertain commentary or questions from the board, starting with perhaps you, Kathy.
Sure. I do just have a couple comments, questions. I just want to clarify, in terms of getting a variance, it's not an easy thing to get. And I, under the first criteria, you're basically saying that the reasoning is that the property is large and the condition of the home is in such disrepair that you can't make that into the it can't have the appearance of a single family home in terms of making it two family. Is that?
I believe that's fair to say, but I would add to that, I appreciate the question because it was on that particular point that I lost my train of thought. So let me clarify that. The board actually considered a case on Washington Avenue in 2013 that was almost the same fact pattern as the instant case. And the issue is that there has to be something about the property which affects your ability to do what you want to do.
Right.
Mm-hmm. At least that affects the property to do what you want to do as a matter of right. And in that case, as I believe is the case here, the size and the dilapidated condition of the property is that characteristic which really impedes your ability to do what you otherwise could do as a matter of right. And that is that being less than 1,800 square feet in size, that in and of itself does not lend itself to a conversion that can be economically viable. When you couple that with the condition of the property, which makes it, I'm not one to overstate things, but nearly impossible to convert in a safe, structurally sound, aesthetically pleasing way. That's the characteristic of this property, is the structure. And specifically, as you pointed out, it's really the size and the condition of the structure that impedes your ability to do it as a matter of right.
For now, I think that's... Go ahead, I'm good. Thank you.
John.
I had a number of technical questions, and then I'm going to pass it and then come back later. But on the architectural plans, and relative to your first statement on the variance criteria, you indicated that section, that the present house sitting on the property occupies 1,774 square feet.
It's my understanding that the current home is a little less than 1,800 square feet, not the proposed.
Okay. And if I calculated it right, the new proposed duplex, each one will have 3,200 square feet. And I think in your statement you indicated that each of the replacement units we're going to have substantially less than the existing structure that's on it. So that's question number one.
Yeah, if I said that, that I don't recall saying that. The proposed structure is as set forth in the plans. I don't second guess your calculation of the square footage of the proposed structure with four bedrooms and a footprint that's shown on the plot plan that's submitted with that. I don't question that square footage. I'm not here saying that the proposed would somehow be comparable or less than the current square footage. To the contrary, it's materially larger, which makes it more economically viable, along with the fact that the actual conversion of the old structure would be difficult regardless of the size.
Well, I'm just referring to the next to last sentence in the criteria two of your variance.
Of my application?
Mm-hmm.
I could take a look
but,
at that.
I mean, the questions that I have right now, Counselor, are relative to the specifics of the proposed structure. And then I want to pass it on and then come back later and discuss a little bit more about the criteria themselves.
If I may, I now see the point in the application that you're raising, and I think that I can address it. The point that I was trying to drive at in the application is, if you took the conversion scenario, given the size of the current house, and you converted that to a two-family, maintaining the appearance of a single-family, those units would be extremely small given the total area of 1774. So
okay.
I understand your confusion there. When I refer to 1,774 square feet of newly created units, I'm referring to under the conversion scenario.
Second question, again, relative to the proposed addition, the proposed duplex. The proposed structure is going to face which direction?
Front on Johannes.
And you're going to have to take down that entire wall that's in front on Johannes to do so, right?
I could not say that definitively, sir. I don't know.
Okay. And the proposed, duplex is going to have two floors, four bedroom, each one with a four bedroom, and then a finished basement or a partially finished basement. I could not gather what that was going to be either.
I'm not sure that the architectural renderings were brought to that point. Obviously there are a number of steps in this process, and really the first threshold that needs to be met if these plans are going to go forward would be the variance. If the board has any opinion on whether or not the finished basement is a good idea or a bad idea, I'd be happy to entertain the board's, whatever the board would consider. I know that my client would be amenable to in terms of conditions.
Okay. And the last question, the entrance to each of the units is going to be on the side but facing Johanna Drive. Which is basically on the first page, I believe.
Looking at the first page rendering?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yep.
And my question is, you had mentioned Washington Street, a conversion down there. It appears to me, been looking at the two structures, This is almost a duplicate of what appears in Washington Street. You don't have to answer that, I just want to make that comment. And in terms of the variance aspect of the criteria, I'm gonna pass and come back to that if I may.
Fine, John. Si, any questions, comments?
Yeah, I do. A little bit of confusion on my part at the moment, listening to John and others, but the official address of this property is 183 Salem Street.
Yes.
And the criteria for a variance is that you, you know, you can build a two-family by right as long as it maintains its appearance as a single-family residence. And when I looked at the layout of the thing, if you're looking at the property from the, from 180, from Salem Street, it would appear to me that it looks somewhat like a single-family residence. And my thought was that you moved the garages over to the Johanna Street side to try to maintain that appearance as a single family, okay? Now, that may or may not be the true case, but it is over that way. And and you got that stone wall there, which I don't know what you would do with that thing. If you're gonna put the garages over on that side and the driveway over on that side, are we gonna maintain that or not, okay? But I don't know, was that the intent in laying out this property to try to move those garages so that they face Johanna Drive, so that it gives you the appearance on Salem Street that it is a single family residence? Was that what drove it?
The first part of the question, I can't give you a yes or no answer. The second part, I can't. The purpose for turning the structure to face Johannes is really to take advantage of 150 feet of
right.
frontage
right.
on that intersecting street.
Right.
I think that most folks would agree that it's probably more desirable to have that address when you're trying to market the properties and sell them in the end. But probably most importantly, by positioning the structure there, you're able to conform with all of the current dimensional requirements and still be able to build a structure that, you know, makes the project viable. The question that, the part of your question that I asked about, words to the effect, by turning it that way, was it to keep a single family appearance? The answer to that is no. The whole point about maintaining the appearance of a single family dwelling, that is the condition that I theoretically on paper, there are probably many architects who could tell me you could convert that structure with those dimensions to a two-family home and maintain the look of a single family. And if we could do that, then we would satisfy the ability to use it as a two-family as a matter of right. In making that point, though, I'm also saying the reason why we're asking for the variance is because in these particular circumstances and the condition of this particular property, that option, even if we could do that, is not economically viable and from a structural standpoint isn't viable. Now, the other way that that point becomes relevant, I think, is in terms of asking oneself whether or not granting the relief derogates from the intent of the bylaw. And I would argue that in this case, it simply does not. And one of the reasons is because under the bylaw, theoretically, you could use this house as a two-family in it, you know, even without this relief. So the point about the appearance of a single family, I think, speaks to two things. Number one, it I believe supports the idea that the granting of this relief doesn't derogate from the intent of the bylaw. And secondly, it speaks to the fact that given the condition of this structure, converting that to a single family and satisfying that element of doing it as a matter of right is just this owner can't do that.
Okay. Because if you go up Salem Street toward center of town, and I don't recall what the exact address of the property is, but there is another two-family, relatively new in appearance, where they basically have a garage facing the street, but then they built another garage going underneath the property perpendicular to Salem Street. So if you look at the property, it looks like a single family, but it, in fact, if you stand in front of it and look at it, you know what's going on, okay?
Right.
So, you know, there's ways to try to make it look as best as you can as a single family while maintaining what you want to do as a two-family property. That's the only reason why I asked the question. There's nothing in the drawings that I saw, and maybe I just missed it, relative to the height of the new structure. I find that dimension.
You know, I'd be happy to provide that. I can tell you that I was clear with my client that all of the dimensional requirements, that would include height, building coverage, all that, would have to be conformed to proceed with this application.
Yeah, what I was getting to was, how does the height of the new structure compare to the height of the existing structure that you're going to tear down? That's pretty big, mm-hmm. what you got there now. Is the new
right.
structure going to be smaller than that, or the same as, or bigger?
I couldn't
answer my question by looking at the
right.
drawings.
Right.
And the other thing,
I'm sorry, go ahead. I was just going to say that one of the things that is difficult about height as well is understanding where you start from, because
correct.
when you develop a site, you know, obviously there's bringing in fill materials and sometimes taking them away. So there's a lot of factors that I think would be somewhat limited in giving you a definitive answer in any case because of that condition.
And the only other comment I would have at this point is I think there are some dimensional discrepancies between the plot plan and the architectural drawings.
Okay, regarding
and
the
we
footprint
can get into that
versus the
later on in the discussion perhaps, but I think there are some dimensional discrepancies which would suggest that the plot plan is not consistent with the architectural drawing. Okay.
Yeah, I appreciate that. The one comment that I would offer in response is that in terms of the record, we would be relying on the plot plan.
Yeah.
In terms of the architectural renderings, they are in large part conceptual based on the ability to meet this first threshold of hopefully getting a variance.
Well, one of the things we kind of look to is that in looking at these cases that the plot plan is the governing document in terms of specific correctness, okay?
Right.
And as I say, it's not consistent in one area specifically with the architectural. We can talk about that later on after some further comments. I don't have any more.
Okay. Nick?
So I understand you could substantially rehab this property by right and create a two-family. What I'm trying to wrap my head around is this first question, the variance criteria,
mm-hmm.
of how this property is so uniquely distressed that the only way that you could, you know, economically make it viable to create a two-family is to demolish it and create it what seems to be a larger two-family. Because someone might argue that, to me, what sounds like, I'm hoping you can elaborate more on this, it seems like a lot of deferred maintenance on this property would be reflected in the sales price. So maybe you could enlighten me on what is so uniquely distressed about this property that it is so damaged to the point that necessitates a demolish and this variance.
I think in terms of the record, the board would probably have to rely on the information provided by the current owner, which my takeaway from that is that, she has talked to a number of contractors about various alternatives of what may be viable before she engaged in negotiations with my client, whose proposal is to raise the existing structure. So from a factual standpoint, I think that the current owner has tested the market. And that is what's economically viable for her, and without this relief, she would experience a financial hardship. In terms of the kind of the legal nuance, I really was found it very helpful to look at the Washington Street case that this board had considered, because it really, the decision of the board, I think, articulated you know, probably better than I can, what the connection between the condition of the structure and how that affects the ability to do what one wants to do as a matter of right. And long story short is that you know, my takeaway from that case is that the board has recognized, and I think appropriately so, that the condition of the property is not limited to the shape of the lot. It's not limited to subsurface conditions and ledge and whatnot and wetlands. That the law actually provides that that the structure and its structural integrity or lack of structural integrity satisfies that requirement.
Okay, just to your knowledge, are you aware of any cost estimates or work write-ups that, you know, distinguish the cost of substantially rehabbing it into a two-family by right versus demolishing it and creating this two-family that you're proposing?
No, I do not have any write-ups in making that comparison. I think that the current owner, you know, would speak from experience on that.
Okay. I have a couple of thoughts, and then, John, I know you said you wanted to get back to it. This case is somewhat similar to a case that we decided on Washington Street in favor of the applicant. That was a little different, I think. There was a historical aspect to that structure as well. And I'm not sure if the sheer scope of the proposed dwelling was, in this case, let's just the ballpark at almost twice the size of the existing dwelling. I don't recall that was the case in that particular variance application. It seems as though, from what we've seen and heard, that some of these plans need to be amended to conform with the drawings. I think that Cy noted that. John, I think, noted a couple of instances. And so perhaps we could provide some suggestions as to how to make that a little bit more specific. And then secondarily, I would just like to comment before John does. I know, John, you want to touch on some of the criteria, but I'd like to particularly touch on the proposed hardship criteria. You know, the law is pretty clear in that, you know, it seems like the hardship presented here is that we're not really able to maximize the value of this land unless we're going to be allowed to build maximize the value of this property if we're not allowed to build the proposed dwelling. And that's not a hardship criteria under Mass law. I can cite to a McCabe case that I'm familiar with, counsel, that specifically stands for that proposition that the theoretical potential of a parcel is not considered a hardship. So, you know, we have, as a board, a requirement to demonstrate whether or not the applicant meets all four criteria, and I'm struggling a little bit with that criteria, and maybe some of my colleagues on the board here can help clear that up for me, or perhaps the applicant can help clear that up for me at some point during the course of tonight. I'm going to go ahead, John, and turn it over to you to go through the issues you might have.
Well, a lot has been made of the Washington Street property, and just like this property, it was a large, comparatively large structure. The first hearing, we asked the building inspector to go back, continue the hearing, so he could go back and check the number of rooms that existed prior to 1942, which he does by inspection purposes, and looks at the nature of the materials that are in the original portion of the house. The property on Washington Street was in extreme disrepair. Portions of it had not been lived in for a number of years. The back portion of the house was falling off. And in reality, this board should have, at that point, said very clearly, you don't meet the criteria of the of the variance, but on top of that, our specific bylaws indicate that you have the right to go back and modify your existing single family based upon the 9 rooms prior to 42, which you could do, which the builder could do, and then decide, or could add an addition to what was down there and convert it to, in the addition aspect of it, put it back into a two-family setting. The board, I think, because of the extreme condition of that property, voted, I think, 5-0-0 to go ahead and take it down, only because it was in such deplorable condition.
And you'll recall that there was a historical aspect, too, that we had to work with the Historical Commission as well.
Yes. But in riding past this property a couple of times, I didn't notice the roof falling in. I didn't notice broken windows. I didn't notice gutters falling off. I noticed this. I did notice, you know, some painting issues, but that's cosmetic. I was never inside the house, nor do I expect to go inside the house. But when the building inspector did write us that recommendation that he put that you just read, he indicated that it was in a degree of disrepair and it could be converted to a two-family very easily. But because back way past 1942, way before 42, it was always considered from 42 to present as a single-family residence, it almost needs to go through that intermediate step to qualify to take it down or to expand upon it or to do anything. That's the difference, I think, between the Washington Street property and Salem Street property. But then I go back and I look at the criteria 1 through 4, and council knows as well as the board that you have to prove all 4 points. The first point is very difficult to prove. Nick touched on it, David touched on it, Cy touched on it. But the other portion of it, I really was hoping that we would have the builder here this evening so we could answer some of those questions, because when you get down to the third criteria, that it doesn't substantially become detrimental to the public good, that is the neighborhood. As I think Cy pointed out, we don't have any height on this property. It can only be 35 to the midpoint of the rafters, but it can be taken from two different levels, the street level and the natural level. And we don't even know what the proposed is for the street versus the natural, what to be if you were to take down the property is to be. We don't know if it's going to be above the stone, the wall, or the whole wall comes down and then you cut into the ground at street level to create the foundation and the basement and then go up 2.5 stories, or we don't have enough facts to even think about this. So I would find that the first and the third criteria is somewhat shaky in terms of your justification. That even brings the fourth one into a question mark in my mind too. I think that either the builder did not spend a lot of time in talking to the owner and projecting what he what he proposed to put on the property. Because it doesn't appear to be using the neighborhood requirement of the intention of the third criteria of the variance. The other question that I have, and council may, we've run into this before, you're changing the address of the house. It is no longer going to be 183 and 185. It's going to be 183A and 183B or something like that. It can't be on Salem Street because it's facing Trahana Drive. So now we're changing the address. What do we have to go through in the town and the postal services to change that? That's, again, curb cuts. A number of questions pop up. So I think the concerns that I have, I wish the builder was here to answer some of the specific questions, because I think that would may be able to solve some of these questions, at least that I have. I'm not sure of the rest of the board members.
John, you bring up a good point. The from the plot plan council that you provided, it speaks of a proposed driveway. Is that going to require a new curb cut?
I presume that it will.
Okay. And so the two new curb cuts?
Perhaps? I presume that it will, yes.
All right. And has the applicant made any inquiries? The Board of Selectmen are the sole road commissioners in the town and have sole jurisdiction over whether or not to grant an application for new curb cuts for a new driveway. Has the applicant made any inquiries with getting before the board?
No. And if I could speak to that in a general sense, I think the questions that are being raised are smart questions. Anytime you're advising a client who's going through a regulatory process, it's always difficult to decide how many tracks to travel at once. So do you get over the first hurdle and then, you know, deal with the other regulatory requirements? Perfectly appropriate questions to ask, and I'm sure that my client, if the board's inclined to continue it, and the owner is amenable to you know, participating in that, I'm happy to, you know, travel as many tracks simultaneously as the board in its discretion deems appropriate. So,
yeah, I mean, ultimately, it's this board's duty to stamp a plan that goes along with your application, should it be approved. Stamping a plan with a driveway on it that hasn't been approved by the road commissioners in town is a bit troubling to me at this point in time, because the Board of Selectmen may take issue, or the town engineer may take, you know, any number of town departments or boards with jurisdiction over that might take issue with it. And so I think your point is a good one, and we might think about framing some questions for you to perhaps take to your client and to the developer, the proposed new owner, and perhaps come back. Maybe we could answer some of those now and not have to come back, but I think given that the board has some unanswered questions, that you're not a builder and you know as much about it as your client and the owner have told you, and perhaps that's something we want to take up with the builder, who has the answers to some of those questions. Go ahead, John.
I do have one last point to make. I feel very badly for the individual who is a property owner being put in that particular position. I think she's being taken advantage of. That this was a hastily put together proposal to tie up the property. I shouldn't say it that way, but it appears that way to me, because all of the questions that we have are based upon an architectural plans that don't seem to fit the property that is the certified plot plan. They seem to be inconsistent with one another. And in terms of the neighborhood, it seems to be very much contra to the neighborhood, which is the third criterion of variance. So I'm feeling poorly about what appears needs to be done, because I don't want to see the person go through the hardship. That hardship is individual. It doesn't align necessarily with the property too.
And before I turn it over to public comment, I have one other question, I guess, to probably clarify for the record. The applicant is what would be the under contract buyer?
Yes.
Who is under contract to purchase the property subject to a variance at this point in time? One of the conditions of the P&S agreement is that the buyer obtain relief from the ZBA in the town to build a two-family on the property?
Yes.
All right, I just want to make that clear for the record.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, I can appreciate when the board or anybody is only privy to, you know, certain information that it may raise questions, but I would want to assure the board that the owner is represented by counsel, and you know, a lot of these things are driven by time constraints, whether they're actual or perceived. Depends from case to case, but certainly I think time is a factor in this case for the parties. Based on the feedback that the board is giving, some of the questions that are being asked, it's my expectation that my client, if the board were inclined to continue it, would do as much work as it takes to provide the information that's necessary for the board to make an informed decision. By the same token, that is a decision that needs to be made hand in hand with the owner and the owner's attorney, understanding that process takes time and money. And so I just would be remiss if not at least assuring members of the board that the owner and her attorney have been part of the process throughout.
Yeah, I think. Perhaps we might have expected that, but thank you for the clarification. All right, at this point, I
just
go ahead, Si. Go ahead, Si.
Okay, I mean, the discussion that I've heard says that the proposed dwelling would require a new curb cut. Okay, the garage that's on the property, that exists on the property now, what was the access to that garage on the property as it existed before this? Well, how did you get to that from 183 Salem Street? I can't tell that from the drawing.
Right, and I can't tell you that.
So there had to be some access to that garage somehow, some way, from either Johanna or 183, which means there was a curb cut somewhere, perhaps.
Right.
And so, but this is a new one, so that's saying it wasn't this area. Somewhere else. I don't know the answer to that question either.
Anything else from any board members at this time? Okay. At this point, I'm going to turn the hearing over to a public comment portion. If there are any members of the audience or those here that have questions for the applicant, for the board, or would like to address the board in any meaningful way regarding this application, if you would identify yourself and your address for Caitlin so that she can reflect that in the minutes, and we're happy to let you be heard. Go ahead, sir.
Hi, I'm Jeffrey Dorenfeld, 1 Arrow Circle, and I have a lot of questions. I'm not sure they're all pertaining to this venue right now, but it's really the location of this new structure that it now fronts a different street, and I guess the proposal would be to, I would imagine, to take down that retaining wall, which I think is owned by the town, or most of it is owned by the town, rather than rather than the landholder right now. And the other is that the land itself is not flat, which is the reason for the retaining wall. And I didn't know if anything was addressed of how the landscaping would fit this new structure, which seems to be much larger than before. And I don't know exactly right now, like, where does the structure currently, how would it fit within the boundaries that it's allowed? Would it be right up to the tip all around? Or is it, like, where is it going to be centered? I wonder if someone could tell us that.
Sure. With respect to the boundaries, I'm pulling out the plot plan. With respect to the boundaries, the current structure is 22 feet and some change off of Salem. The proposed would be 45 feet set off from Salem Street. That structure would be 30 feet at its closest point from the adjacent property on Johanna. And then
on Johanna?
There's no property on Johanna.
On the street.
The property that fronts on Johanna, as you stand on Salem Street, behind the property, it would be at its closest point 30 feet from that rear lot line, which if fronting on Johanna, would be the side lot line. Am I making that clear?
So are you saying the front or the back of?
I guess the garage.
Right, the garage, on the current configuration with the house fronting on Salem Street, what I refer to as the rear lot line would be back in the corner where the garage is. So that, in facing a new structure to Johanna, then that setback from that adjacent property would be 30 feet at its closest point.
That makes sense. So where would the front of this new house end on Joanna? Would it be right? Would the corner be at the sidewalk? How far back?
No, the corner would be structure would be set off of Johanna, and the 42.4 feet.
So is that a conforming setback for the front of the house? Is that
yes?
Okay.
Yep. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? You, sir, in the red shirt, with the red and white shirt.
I live at 191 Salem Street. I just wondering, are there any other copies of this plot plan that we can see? So we can see exactly where the house is going to be on the lot and what you have. Are there driveway plans on the plot plan that show where the driveway and the cutouts are going to be on Johanna Drive?
Yeah, well, one of the things that, and I think that the question of curb cuts on Johanna is a smart question. I think that I need to circle back with my client and be clear as to whether or not he can do a curb cut on Salem Street. The issue of street addresses is a different issue, but he may very well be able to run a driveway in from Salem Street and access the garages off of that driveway. So. I'm happy to give, if you give me a name and address, I'd be happy to get you copies of the plot plan. But in terms of dimensional setbacks, just to put it in perspective, the garage right now is 8 feet from what I consider to be the current rear lot line. The new structure would be at its closest point, the 30 or so feet that I just referenced from.
Rita Bridges, 191 Salem Street, and it's, you're referring to curb cuts, but on Johanna there are no established curbs as it stands now, so that's an address, I mean, that's going to be addressed.
If the board is inclined to continue the hearing, what I would like to do is to confirm with my client whether or not he can use a curb cut on Salem Street to access the proposed garages that would face Johanna. Also, based on what the board is raising as questions, you know, I'll encourage my client, with the agreement of the current owner, to consult with whatever town departments the board wants, would prefer to get those answers. So that, you know, I think that it's possible to do it either way. We could either do a curb cut on Salem, I presume. I presume that the builder would prefer to go on Johanna, but hearing the questions that are being raised here tonight, you know, I think we need to explore the Salem Street curb cut.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Tony?
Mr. Chairman, I was not.
Oh.
I was not sworn in.
Tony, you want to be sworn in?
Yes, please.
I swear that the testimony given by me before this board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Response is I do.
I do.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, reference has been made to the Washington Street address, and even back then I questioned why a variance was granted for it.
Mr. DiRezzo, could I ask you to identify your name and address for the record, please?
I apologize, Mr. Chairman. Tony DiRezzo, 130 John Street.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Please continue.
Back when the Washington Street property was granted a variance, I always questioned why it was allowed, because the condition of the building is not one of the conditions for a variance. It's the soil condition, the topography, the lot shape, of the shape of the lot or structure, but not the condition of the building. If it weren't for the condition of the building, anybody could let their property run down and be granted a variance for almost anything. So the fact that the property may be in disrepair is not a condition for a variance. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, for the record, Robert Buckley, Raymond Bronstein, I represent Linda Kachmar, who is at 176 Salem Street, which is directly across the corner of Winter Street. It sounds from the tenor of the discussion here that this is going to be continued. I just want to point a clarification. The chair indicated that the public portion would be open now. I assume that you'll continue the public portion for comment based upon revised plans, and will the public have an opportunity to review those plans and comment?
Counsel, you're correct. If the right. hearing is continued, at any continuance of the hearing, we would perhaps entertain a public comment period as well.
When you say perhaps?
If there's new information presented at the continued hearing, we'd add an area for public comment on that new information presented.
And for the record, I could just say counsel for the applicant has been very cooperative with us in addressing some of our concerns, and I would expect that would continue. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other comment? Yes, Kim.
Kim Saunders, 18 Union Street. It's my mother's house, and I just want to say that the house is in disrepair. We go in the back of the house. The roof has fallen in. There's animals in the attic. There's animals in the cellar. The cellar is leaking. It is in disrepair. So for you guys to say it's not, she did put new windows in because the heating bill was so high. You guys aren't in the house. You don't know what quality the house is in. She approached four builders. They all had the same suggestions that they could not repair it. She had a real estate person come in, and she said, "You won't sell it." The house across the street that did get done took a year to be sold. So for you to make her wait for another, if this gets continued, another winter, another bad season, it's a lot on her. She tried to stay in there. She had a daughter move in from Florida. If she moved back to Florida, she's by herself. She can't shovel. She's by herself. So for you guys to say it's not in disrepair, it is in disrepair, and she cannot upkeep it. And that's all I wanted to say. And she did get quotes from other contractors.
Kaylin, I'd like to let the record show that Kim is a de facto member of the Board of Appeals and a town employee whose input we greatly respect and admire. But let the record show she's typically the recording secretary for the board. Doesn't discount anything that you've said.
Thanks.
I
didn't do the minutes neither, because I didn't want to be.
I just want to make sure the record reflects that, Kim. Anybody else
have anything to add as part of the public portion? Yes, ma'am.
Cheryl Dornfeld, 1 Arrow Circle. I just wanted to say I all the concerns of the height is a concern, and all, and also the basically changing the direction of the property would be on Joanna Drive. I mean, I think those are two big issues that should be thought about and taken into consideration. I know you've addressed them. I just wanted to say that I think they're should be looked at into.
Thank you. All right, for today's hearing, I'm going to close the public portion of the hearing right now. The board's discussions with the applicant, it sounds as though we were perhaps working toward suggesting perhaps a continuation of today's hearing so that you could either consult your client on a number of items that were presented by board members, as well as perhaps members of the public, perhaps at the continuation, bring the developer in or somebody who's responsible for the design of the building, so that we could perhaps address some of the plan versus drawing issues that we've identified. Any other members of the board have anything to say related to the application and where the discussion sits right now?
The only comment I would make is that in relooking at this thing, if we have a continuation, is that the plot plan, I think, is not a very good representation of the actual proposed structure. So you need to look at both of those things, and they need to be correct with one another. But I don't think the plot plan is correct right now. I'm assuming the construction plan is more specific.
Well, one thing that's not been addressed here is that in any situation where the lot permitted on a takedown, the whole property comes into conformance. We still have a garage that sits in the back. It's 0.2 feet from the, it is now the side lot line, it will now be the rear lot line.
Well, I'm operating on the premise, John, that the garage is going to be torn down.
That's not...
But that's an assumption on my part, which I shouldn't make.
You didn't say it in the
description, say it.
Sorry.
I know that. So, right, so I think we would, I think the board requires some clarification on a number of issues. I'm going to go ahead and make a giant leap that you don't want the board to vote tonight on what's been presented.
Please.
And so we would entertain a request from the applicant for a continuance, if that's what the applicant would like to do.
That is.
Right. And so how long do you think the applicant would require to get the questions answered, perhaps plans drawn up? I know our... September, well, our August is... Sorry?
You could go to September
1st. Yeah. Let me just look at the upcoming dates. So...
That's extending it. If we're just getting answers to the questions that the applicant developer slash developer could answer, I know we canceled the meeting on August the 18th because there was nothing coming before the board, well, but if the room is free, I'd rather get it over with and bring them back here next Thursday.
There's also an issue of
that's right.
Board members present.
Missing two
I'm
board
not
members.
Here and Kathy's not
Kathy's
here.
Not here.
And that's as we sit here today. That's one of the main reasons why we... And so and the next date is the 25th, but we have the Lincoln Street 40B scheduled for that. We are going to be meeting on September 1st. There's been some back and forth with town staff regarding whether it was the 1st or the 8th, but the 8th is the election, so it'd have to be the 1st. We have two cases on as it sits right now. I don't know if those are going to stay there based upon the status of those cases, but then the next available date after September 21st, September's kind of a quirky month here in Reading with a number of things that are going on both election-wise and town meeting-wise, so there are going to be a lot of full nights, but the next available date after September 1st, if September 1st doesn't work for you, is September 22nd. So I would defer to the applicant to let us know when you'd like to try to come back. September 1st is probably the earliest. September 22nd is, what, about 7 weeks, six, 7 weeks out?
Okay. If I could, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to think out loud with you for a moment here. On the one hand, I'd like to move as expeditiously as possible, and I'm sure the board would. So in that regard, I'm inclined to say September 1st. By the same token, based on the comments of the board, I want to make darn sure that the people on whom my client relies to provide paperwork and information, given that it's the summer months, what I don't want to do is, take advantage of the board's courtesies and then not be ready for September 1. So I guess my inclination is to schedule it for September 1st, and if it's appropriate in your discretion, Mr. Chairman, if we're having trouble because of vacations or whatnot, getting the right people to reduce things to paper, I would communicate that with you and notify you that we would, that we're not where you want us to be.
That's fine. If your scheduling becomes an issue prior to that September 1st hearing, you can communicate with town staff. They would more than likely entertain a written request for a further continuance. We're going to be here September 1st anyways. We'd probably still have to come in and vote on that request for continuance on the 1st. More than likely, okay, wouldn't have to be here for that. But, you can certainly...
Yeah, that being said, then I would request September 1st.
Yeah, that's fine. So we will now entertain a motion to accept the applicant's request for continuance of the hearing until September 1st. Anybody?
So moves.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Second by John. Any discussion on the motion for continuance?
Well, I think council has a list. I see him writing down the list of all the concerns that the board had. So rather than what we've done, if there's major issues that we want answered, we've always included those. But since council wrote them down, I think, and there's quite a few of them, we're
pretty comfortable that you have a marching list of a list of marching orders, questions, concerns that you can take back to your client, to the design team?
I believe that I do.
Okay. Hearing no further discussion, we've had a motion and a second. We'll have a vote. Everybody is 1, 2, 3. So five of us are voting tonight. All in favor of the continuance? 5-0-0. Unopposed? Continuance is granted. See you on September 1st. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you, everybody. We'll do it during the continuance.
Yeah. It's messy, really messy. That's interesting.
They need to bring that information back to the board. We would like it before that night. But again, if it makes a difference for us to move forward, we'd rather have it be, presented so that we can move on September 1. If it's canceled or to be continued, I think either Maureen or Kim puts it on the website.
Yes.
So you could go right to the Reading website and get it.
When it gets up, every time it gets updated, it gets put on the website. Yeah, very often.
And there's a special spot on the website?
Yep, if you go to the zoning board of appeals, they have their own page, and it says schedule right there, and you can include it. Yep.
Thank you.
So many of these.
All right, the only remaining items for this evening for the board are some minutes.
Which I didn't get to read.
Well, take a few minutes and let's go through them.
On case 1602, is that the first one you're looking at?
Yeah.
Normally that's done, especially in 40Bs, in front of the hearing. Because the other people who may have input into that would be staff members or other people sitting besides just the five of us. Do you want to hold
so
that
what
one
I, So what I think you're saying is that these minutes should be reviewed at the hearing for the 40B, so other staff members are
right.
Present.
I would suggest.
I don't have any problem deferring to the next meeting. That's fine. We can defer review and voting on the minutes till the what is it? The
25th.
20. When is it?
25th.
25th.
Whatever.
Yeah. Whatever that next meeting is. Have the list. All right, that being the case, it appears that we have, all right, so just as a matter of note, so we're gonna be having a September 1st. There was some discussion as to whether or not it would be the 1st or the 8th, and when we were at one of the last meetings, we said we wanted to have a meeting the first meeting in September, whatever that was. We weren't sure what it was. We thought it was the 8th before we perhaps realized that it's the election. So we are going to be having a meeting. There are cases scheduled for. I don't know if they'll stay scheduled for, but we have cases scheduled, including this continuance, to the 1st. So just so that the board's aware, it's going to be the 1st.
So we have two continuances on the 1st and one new case.
Didn't we just have the...
One is...
Two scheduled and one, and the continuance would be number 3.
Yeah.
Well,
one's
one
a continuance,
the...
too. Bancroft Ave, 1613,
right.
Is a continuance.
So
yeah, but that's
that.
Already on the schedule. One, that's on the schedule.
Yeah.
Right.
I understand that the applicant has filed either a new application or a much revamped application, so they're going to discuss whether or not that needs to be re-advertised and whether or not that will still be re-advertised in time for September 1st. But
Wakefield Street,
we'll
Wakefield Street is a new one. That's right.
Correct.
That's a new one.
Okay.
Correct.
But we don't have anything on that yet.
I don't think we have any
okay.
materials on that yet. My guess is we'll get them in the mail.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or
okay.
At the next meeting on the 25th. All right. That seems to be enough for tonight. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Kathy, second?
Second.
Second by Cy. All in favor? 5-0-0. We are adjourned. Thank you, everybody. Thanks for filling in, Caitlin.